In this video, we're going to talk about how you can get a free domain and a hosting plan, then how to set up the database and tables inside phpMyAdmin, and we'll create a simple API after that. And later on, we are going to create a RESTful API with all the CRUD operations. Welcome back to yet another video of channel CodeX. This is your host Afzal, and as I said, today we are going to talk about the API creation. So it is going to be a very long video, like 30-40 minutes of video. So get yourself into the zone and let's get started. So first of all, let me clarify your doubt. You may be thinking that why in today's world I'm not talking about MongoDB and DocumentDB structure. Instead, I'm teaching a relational database with PHP. So the reason is relational database like MySQL, SQL Server are used in so many companies, so many industries, and there are so many opportunities out there. And PHP with frameworks like Laravel, Slim, they're very powerful and they're very easy to use. So don't get driven by the YouTube videos that everybody is using MongoDB, relational database. The fact is MySQL and relational database still exist and PHP is a very powerful language. Well, that being clarified, let's get started with a free domain registration. All right, so we are going to visit to this site. I have added link in the description if you want to follow along. Go ahead and click on sign up. Fill out this simple form and don't get scared of the captcha. After a couple of wrong tries, you should be able to get it. Just kidding. Okay, once you activate the account, go to main menu and login. And pause the video if you want to follow along. Once you are logged in, you can click on subdomains menu where you will find all the registered subdomains, just like this one. Now let's add a new subdomain. Click on add button. Here you have to select domain from which you will create subdomain. It is your personal preference. There are some other options as well if you want to explore, but I personally like moo.com because it's simple and easy to remember. Next, you need to choose subdomain name. Remember, it should be unique. For example, API Codex Dev. You can even try your name here. All right, enter captcha and hit save. Bam. Here you have a brand new subdomain, all yours to explore. Now select and delete it. Don't worry, that was just for demo. I already have a subdomain which we are going to use in this tutorial. That is codexdev.moo.com. Let's try to visit this site and see what we get. Nothing. Reason, because we don't have any code running on this site. It's just pointing to nothing. Now to make this work, we need to create an HTML page and host it somewhere. For that purpose, we'll be using free Hostia. I personally prefer free Hostia because it gives 5 domains to explore. Once you click sign up, you will get this form. And most important thing here is hosted domain. You need to pick a domain which is not taken. It can be any random domain, doesn't matter. We are going to delete it later on. So just type anything you want, fill out this form and complete the registration for free. And once you have verified your account, you can log in from here. Cool. Now you have successfully created a hosting account. Go to your hosted domain and you will find out the domain which you entered earlier, which is just a fake domain, right? Go ahead and delete it. Now we are going to host our newly created subdomain, which we created in the last step, right? So just enter the subdomain and here I'm going to type in codexdev.moo.com. It may be different for you. Don't register the same domain. Okay. Now expand the advanced setting and you will find several configuration for this domain. Let's copy the IP address from here. We will use that just in a moment. Click add host and you're done. You should see your domain in the listing now. Perfect. Now we will go back to the site where we registered our subdomain and we will modify the destination IP to what we have just copied. Now let me summarize what we have done so far. We created a subdomain, right? We created a hosting plan and now we are redirecting this subdomain to that hosting plan. So anytime you call codexdev.moo.com, it is going to free Hostia server and whatever file it finds there, it will just render for you. So now we don't have any file. Our codex.moo.com is empty. You can see it over here. So what we are going to do, we are going to create index.html, which is going to be our default page, or you can say default site. So here I am going to write some basic HTML code inside this HTML file, which will just say hello world, nothing else. And let me also give you a quick tip that if you don't see your site or the website is still loading, which means your server is updating the address. So give it like 2-3 hours and it will be working. And here we have the hello world message from our HTML page. Time to celebrate. Alright, I hope your server is running, you're not getting that infinite loading page, and your whatever you have written inside this index.html you can see on the web page. You can also add some CSS file and more HTML files to just create a full web page, and you can even put them inside a folder to manage all the styles and assets. For that you can use FTP account if you don't want to upload and create all the files directly. But for this demo we will focus on file manager, because we have only like 2-3 files to create. And with that, we have completed our hosting and domain registration part. Let's move to the database creation. Click on database menu and select MySQL database. And here we are going to add a SQL database. So you can simply click on add SQL button, provide the name of your database, and you can keep the database name something generic. So if you're creating employee application, don't just say it employee, because employee will be a name of table. So database name is something like a project name. So here I'm going to call it CodeX. That's my database, and you can change the password if you want, but I'm going to keep the same password as my account. Now once your database is ready, you can click on phpMyAdmin, which will open this interface where you can manage your database, create tables, and do all sort of SQL operation. Here you will find all the details of your database, like which IP address it is running, what is the username. If you want to connect from your local machine, you can do that. So let's go ahead inside our database and create a brand new table. You can also use SQL editor to write the command or write a SQL query, but I'm going to use the interface and provide, you know, some simple name of table, which is employee. It is going to have 4 columns. You can modify that later on, so don't worry about that. You can add column, remove column, everything is customizable. And let's quickly add a simple employee structure. So there will be ID, name, and email. And you can define ID as primary key with auto increment. So each time you add a record inside this table, ID will be automatically incremented to next value, and it will be integer, it will be primary. So there cannot be a duplicate ID of the employee. Well, that's all like a, more like a database structure and database knowledge, which I'm not expert into it, but I know a little bit of basics, which will be enough for this tutorial. Alright, so this is a basic structure of our table. Let's go ahead and see if we have any record. Of course not, because we didn't add anything. Let's go ahead and insert one record. Now remember that you don't have to enter the ID value, because it's auto increment and primary, so it's going to handle itself. And let's provide the values for name, email, and profile picture. Now for profile picture, I'm going to use URL. So I will just search my name on internet and let's see what comes up. Not bad. At least some images are there on Twitter, and some of YouTube videos thumbnails are coming. Let's go ahead and copy this profile picture here, profile picture link from here, and paste inside profile pic column, and let's go ahead and insert it. Perfect. One row inserted, and you can learn about the query, how it automatically created the query for you if you want to understand more of SQL thing. But here we have our first record, and similar way I'm going to add one more record. And we are done with our database and table creation. Now we have to read these records from our server. For that, we will create a PHP file, write simple API to fetch all the records and show it to user, which we will learn in the next section. So let's go ahead to the file manager again, and here in the root directory, I will create API folder. So anything related to the API will go inside this folder. And index.html is lying on the root level. So anytime you go to codexdev.moo.com, you're gonna see the index file. But if you put /API, you're gonna land inside this folder. So here we will create employee.php. So this file will contain all the operation related to employee. Now we will perform the CRUD operation, we'll do the database connection, and everything we'll do later on in this video. But for time being, let's go ahead and write some simple PHP code and see whether it is working fine or not. We're able to execute PHP code on the server, we're getting the response back and something, just to test out. So I will write a simple echo command with hello employee. All right, let's just save this file and go to the browser. Let's see whether whatever we have written is working or not. I'm just going to type /api/employee.php. And let's see what comes up. Not found. Of course, because we created a file employees.php and not employee.php. And here we have our message. Perfect. Time to celebrate again. Okay, now we are going to add JSON encode to this hello employee just to test out, because all the time we are going to respond back with a JSON structure, not just a plain text, so that user can parse it. Okay, so I'm just going to add a JSON code and refresh the website, and here it added a code. It converted it to a JSON, valid JSON string, right? So everything is working fine. Now it's time to create a database connection and perform the SQL operation, get the data and read everything. So for that purpose, I will create connection.php. And it is a good idea to create connection in a separate file, because you may need the same connection in different files, like employee.php, user.php and something like that. And basically this connection file contains all the information of the database. So where is the database, the server name, what is the username of the database, which you can find inside the phpMyAdmin. This information is your username and of course your password, which you created earlier. And with all those information, it is going to talk to the SQL server. It will establish a connection. And if the credentials are wrong, then it is going to throw the exception that connection was not established. But if the connection is successfully established, it is going to give you the connection string using which you can perform all the DB operation. You can write SQL queries, fetch data, insert data, update data, and everything you can perform with that. So here in this class, we just have one method, getConnectionString, which is, you know, like establishing a connection with the database and returning you the connection string. Simple as that. And don't worry, all of this source code is already on GitHub. You can find link in the description. Now let's go to employees.php file and use this connection to fetch data. First of all, we'll have to include the connection.php file so that we can make reference to database class. And now let's save the file and check whether everything is still working. Generally, I prefer to check at every single step so that we come to know if there's any issue. All good. So let's move ahead and create an object of database class. Also, let's make a call to get connection string using the DB object. Generally, when we do full-time PHP development, we use local editor with IntelliSense, so it gives all the suggestions and code completions. But for demo, we are good with the inbuilt editor. Perfect. Our database connection is running without any issues. That's good. Now it's time to run some SQL query and fetch records from the database. It's pretty simple. We use the connection and perform the query. We are also checking here if there are any records with this query. If yes, then we'll go through the loop and each record we will add inside the response array. It's quite straightforward, but still, if you need, you can refer to the GitHub page for exact code. All right, now we are going to display the response with the echo keyword. Notice that we're using JSON encode to convert the response array to a valid JSON. And if you are still watching the video, a like will be much appreciated. All right, now let's save the file and check if you are getting the two records which we inserted earlier in the DB. And here we have it. Amazing. Time to celebrate. This is the right time to introduce Postman application in the picture. Generally, we test API with the help of some client application, and Postman is one of the widely used app. Here we go, we have the same response here as well. But one thing you will notice that the response doesn't have any JSON format, it's just a plain text. We can easily fix that by providing header just before we echo the response. The header here just informs that HTTP client that the response I'm giving is in a JSON format. Let's go ahead and check that. Here we have a nicely formatted JSON. Okay, at this point, whatever operation you call, it will always give you the same response because we have not considered the get, post, put and delete in our PHP file. So back to our employees.php, we are going to find out what method user has called, and based on that we will give the response. Of course, we need to detect the method before performing any action. So let's write the code on top here. In PHP, you can simply get all the session related information inside $server object. And here what I'm doing is checking the request method inside the server. Perfect. Now we are going to perform switch case on the request method. We can have different cases like get, delete, put and post, but for now I'm just going to focus on the get case. And other than get, we will just throw an exception from the header that this method is not implemented. So let me take a moment and talk about the PHP syntax. If you look at the switch statement object declaration, you will feel that it's quite similar to Dart language or other language like C# or Java, because at the end these all are object oriented language, and we have the concept of class, we have the concept of function, switch case, if statement, everything remains same. So you don't have to bother about learning a new language, because it's just matter of learning a new syntax, which will take like week or so. So you will get familiar with learning a new language very easily if you have your core concepts clear. Okay, so what we have done so far, whatever we have written earlier, the SQL query and execution of that, we just put it that inside a function, and we are calling that on a get case. For default case, which is like other than get, anything comes, it will just throw an exception. And the way, not an exception, we will tell the API that this method is not implemented on this server. So you can use header for something like this. And here we are specifying HTTP standard with a status code of 405. Now there are different status code, something in the range of 200 means successful, 300 means redirection, 400 means something bad from the client side, 500 means there's something wrong in the code. So let's not bother about that. I'm going to save and send the get request. And bam, we received a 500 internal server error, means there's something wrong in our code. Right, whenever you see 500, you have to look into your code, find out the issue, because your code gave exception at runtime and nobody knows what happened. Don't worry, we are going to inspect the code and find out what is wrong. That is something you need to learn with PHP, that not always you're gonna get a proper exception and line number. So you have to read your code again and understand what is going wrong. In this case, the connection reference was wrong, because now we put our code inside a function, so it doesn't have reference to the connection variable. So we have to declare it as global connection. Now it can refer to the DB connection which we made earlier. And now let's save, and hopefully it should work now. Perfect, here is the response. All right, so our get method is working. Now let's go ahead and change it to post and try to send. We should receive 405 status code, and sometime the request may take time because it's a free server. And here we have 405 method not implemented. All right, so same thing we are going to test on Google Chrome as well. So I'm just going to open Chrome and run this PHP file, and here we have the response. But there's something wrong. The API ends with .php, so the client knows that this has been implemented in a PHP language. Client should not be aware of what language, what architecture, what technology you're using on the server side. So now we are going to convert this simple API into RESTful API. And also we are going to implement the get, put, post and delete, all the CRUD operation. But that will be in the part two of this video, because this video is becoming very lengthy and there's so much to consume, so much to understand. So I will see you guys in the next part. Make sure to subscribe if you're new here, hit the like if this video helped you in any sense, and I will see you guys in the next one.